Welcome to all of you. In last lecture, I discussed about some of the quality parameters of petrol. So I discussed mostly about the quality parameters which affects a smooth running of engine. Basically, I discussed what are the quality parameters which affects easy starting of engine, which may affect vapor lock of engine, a smooth running of engine. And I also discuss about the quality parameter which affects evaporation losses from the car fuel tanks. Now, in this video, I am going to discuss about some other quality parameters which affects mostly environmental pollution from the automobiles. So, basically, I will discuss about why there is a limit on sulfur content, why there is a limit on lead content. So, all these things will be discussed. So, let us start our discussion. See, any automobiles which uses hydrocarbon fuels such as gasoline, diesel or jet fuel as a source of power basically emits a large amounts of pollutants during its exhaust strokes. Some of the pollutants are listed here, like carbon monoxide, unburnt hydrocarbons, nitrogen oxides, particulate matters, sulfur oxide. Now, out of these pollutants, the first two, carbon monoxide and unburnt hydrocarbon, basically form due to incomplete combustion of fuel. We know that whenever any hydrocarbon burns completely or goes for complete combustion, then basically the flue gas form will be carbon dioxide and water. But if there is insufficient oxygen, then we know that there will be incomplete combustion and the product will be carbon monoxide and water. And if there is further incomplete combustion, then it may be possible that some of the hydrocarbon may remain unburnt. Okay, so that's why these two carbon monoxide and unburnt hydrocarbons form due to incomplete combustion. Now, whenever we see the smoke is coming out from the tailpipe of any car or any motorcycle, that is because of this unburnt hydrocarbon. Because a smoke may be a combination of different types of hundred of types of chemicals or fumes, but the visible part of a smoke is basically mostly carbon, which is also called soot. And that forms due to incomplete combustion. Okay. Now, this nitrogen oxides may form when their complete combustion is almost complete. Because whenever there is complete combustion, the temperature inside the combustion chamber goes very high. And at very high temperature, the nitrogen part of air, because the engine is taking air from atmosphere, so it will also contain nitrogen, and at very high temperature even nitrogen react with oxygen and forms different types of nitrogen oxides. So this is when complete combustion. Now, this particulate matter is basically a combination of soot, which is due to unburnt hydrocarbon, and other solid phase materials such as fuel derived sulfate, unburnt lubricant oils, wear metals, kind of things. So, particulate matter is basically a broad way of telling, broad way of combining different types of solid or liquid phase material which is emitting out of car tailpipe. So there will be always a trade-off between particulate matter and nitrogen oxide, because if there is incomplete combustion, then particulate matter will be high and nitrogen oxide will be less, and if there is complete combustion, then particulate matter will be very less and nitrogen oxide will be high. So there will be a trade-off. And finally, sulfur oxide, due to reaction of sulfur from fuel with oxygen. Okay, so our aim should be we restrict our quality parameters such that all these pollutant get reduces at acceptable limit. Okay, so Let us first discuss about what are the problem with these pollutants. These are basically deleterious for environment as well as human health. For example, carbon monoxide, if it enters into the blood, basically binds with hemoglobin and ultimately it reduces the transport of oxygen. Similarly, hydrocarbons, which basically comes from unburnt hydrocarbon, or it may also come from evaporation losses, basically react with NOx and sunlight and ultimately forms ozone. And we know that ozone at upper level of earth crust basically is good for our health, but ozone at ground level is very deleterious for our health, because ozone irritates the eyes, aggravates respiratory problems, and basically cause crop damages. Similarly, nitrogen oxide, which basically formed due to high temperature combustion, may also affect respiratory system, causes pneumonia and lung infection. Similarly, particulate matters may irritate the respiratory system and may also carry metals, sulfates, nitrate, etc. with the soot. And ultimately, oxides of sulfur may also affect respiratory system. So there are various types of problem associated with this. I just mentioned the main problem with these pollutants. Okay, so how we can reduce the toxic substances which is emitting from the combustion engines? Now there are three possible ways. The one is fuel quality improvements, which is the main topic of our discussion. Apart from this, automobile manufacturers also do improvement in their engine, and this is called primary measure, and they also do some improvement outside of the engine, that is also called secondary measure. Basically, what they do is they treat the exhaust which is coming out of the engine. So we need to discuss some basic about this secondary measure. Basically, it uses different types of catalytic converter inside the tailpipe of car exhaust. So basically, whenever there is an engine and the engine is emitting pollutants from its exhaust stroke, there will be a catalytic converters which convert the pollutants into less harmful gases. Okay, so this is catalytic converter. So let us first discuss about catalytic converter, because some of the quality parameters are because to basically improve the performance of catalytic converter. So it will be clear when I will complete this discussion. So let us first start our discussion about catalytic converter, how it works. So basically, catalytic converter is a device which is used to reduce the toxicity of emission from an internal combustion engine. Basically, it is placed inside the tailpipe through which deadly gases are emitted, which I have just shown. And the function of catalytic converter is to convert these gases, harmful gases like carbon monoxide, unburnt hydrocarbons, nitrogen oxide, into less harmful gases like carbon dioxide. H2O is of course not harmful. Nitrogen and oxygen is also not harmful. So how it works? Basically, there are two types of catalytic converter. One is called two-way catalytic converter, and another is called three-way catalytic converter. So three-way catalytic converters basically uses catalysts like platinum, rhodium, and palladium as a catalyst, in which some part of catalyst based as oxidation catalyst and some part of catalyst basically acts as reduction catalyst. So what happens in the tailpipe during reduction process? Nitrogen oxide breaks into nitrogen and oxygen due to this catalyst, rhodium or platinum catalyst, and oxygen of that oxygen which comes from nitrogen oxide basically react with carbon monoxide and form carbon dioxide. Similarly, unburnt hydrocarbon goes to complete combustion and ultimately carbon dioxide forms. So these way we reduce the emission of carbon monoxide, nitrogen oxides, and unburnt hydrocarbon. So in two-way catalytic converter, this reaction does not take place. That is, reduction of nitrogen oxide does not take place. And because of that reason, it only converts carbon monoxide and unburnt hydrocarbons. Okay. Now, let us back to our main discussion about the limitation on some of the parameters in petrol quality. So in BS4 there is a limitation on lead content, like there is maximum allowable limit is 0.005 gram per liter. And why there is limitation? This limitation basically comes because this lead is a poison of catalytic converter catalyst. So if there will be lead in fuel, so it will ultimately poison the catalytic converter catalyst, and then catalytic converter will not work, and ultimately carbon monoxide, unburnt hydrocarbons and nitrogen oxide will emit through car's engine. So that's why there this limitation came, and later it was found that it is even harmful for our human health. For example, the lead which when react with oxygen forms lead oxide, and these are basically injurious to health. For example, lead is somehow linked with lowering of brain function in child or in children. So that's why there is another reason to put the limitation. So earlier what happened at very early 1900s, like 1920, 1930, people used to put lead inside petrol, because if you put tetraethyl lead in petrol, then it will improve octane number at very high number, and so that you will be allowable to design a car with very high compression ratio. But later it was found that lead, tetraethyl lead basically may cause poison of catalytic converter catalyst. So there was a ban, and ultimately later found that it is also harmful to human health. So there is a limitation on lead. Now, there is a limitation on sulfur. Why? Because we know that sulfur can also deactivate the metal catalyst, and that's why we know that whenever there is a catalytic reforming unit or isom unit, basically they first treat naphtha in hydro treatment reactors, so like naphtha hydro treatment unit will be there, so that it will reduce the sulfur quantity of naphtha, because we know that sulfur is basically may deactivate the catalyst, platinum catalyst or palladium catalyst, and that's why this is again here it also work in same way. So one problem with sulfur is it may deactivate the catalyst of catalytic converter. Sulfur also forms SOx, and we know that even with the use of catalytic converter, we cannot reduce SOx emission, because catalytic converter only reduce NOx emissions, carbon monoxide and unburnt hydrocarbons. So there is another problem with sulfur. And sulfur may turn into sulfate during combustion, and we know that sulfate is basically one of the component of particulate matters in exhaust. Apart from these three problems, there is another problem. Sulfur basically when react with oxygen forms sulfur oxides, and they are corrosive. Even elemental sulfur and H2S, RSH, that is mercaptan, all are corrosive. Okay. Now, how they are corrosive? Basically, sulfur oxides react with water vapor, which forms sulfurous acid, and which ultimately oxidize to form sulfuric acid. And we know that sulfuric acid is a very strong acid, and what it does, it may corrode the car engines. Okay. Apart from this, when it goes outside, sulfur oxide goes outside into atmosphere, they at that point it may react with water vapor and ultimately form sulfuric acid, which may cause acid rain. So there is another problem with sulfur, corrosion, acid rain. Apart from this, presence of mercaptan sulfur and hydrogen sulfide also may be the reason they may cause another problem, that is they are very extremely unpleasant odor. So the odor of petrol will goes very bad. So, and we know that whenever there is a corrosion, then what happens? There will be rust formation, and because of the rust formation, there will be plugging inside the engine as well as the combustion chambers and the intake and outlet valves. So there will be disturbance of fuel air mixture. So basically, sulfur will inhibit a smooth burning of fuel. So we may see that there are large number of problems associated with sulfur, and because of that, there should be a limit on sulfur for petrol. And currently there is a limit on sulfur. Is maximum allowable limit is 50 ppm. Okay, earlier in BS3 it was 150 ppm, and in BS6 it will be even further reduced to 10 ppm, because we can understand that other pollutants may be reduced through catalytic converters, but sulfur, there is no other way. We have to reduce in fuel itself, and that's why there is a limitation on sulfur 50 ppm up to 2020, and after 2020 when BS6 will be implemented, this limitation will be further strict, and it will be up to 10 ppm. So anyway, I'm going to stop this discussion right now here. In next part, I will discuss about some other quality parameter of petrols. For example, I will discuss about oxidation stability or storage stability of petrol, why there is a limitation on aromatics or olefin contents. And in the last part, I will discuss about the oxygenates content on petrol. So hope you are enjoying these lectures. Thank you for watching.